There's, sorry, I'm Councillor Linda Maloney, Chair of this meeting, and now declare the meeting open. Any apologies for absence? I have up to now, I've got Barbara Murray, Jimmy Mahon and Paul Tweed. Is that all the apologies in? I've also got apologies from Kieran Timmons. Kieran's can't make this meeting today, it's his last day with the authority. We understand. Oh, thank you, Ian, thanks for attending. There is one matter of urgency that I agreed to take, which is item 8. The reason that it was delivered late was because the information on that report was only given on the 26th of July.
Yeah, it's just we just wanted to conclude some consultation with the representative bodies, and that concluded on, I think, around about that time, so it just meant that it was just delayed slightly, but rather than bring a report subject to consultation, we prepared to bring a report with the consultation concluded for the members to be aware of.
And we all agree. minutes at the last meeting on the 23rd of October 2014 submitted for approval and signature of the chair. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Item three on the agenda is on page 9.
Thanks, Chair. I'll open this report up for discussion. The purpose of the report is to update members on the performance of what we've described as our new automatic fire alarm policy since it was introduced in 2012. And this report was considered by the Performance and Scrutiny Committee and referred on to members of Community Safety and Protection Committee for their consideration, particularly with the recommendations that I will discuss in a little bit more detail. Those recommendations being that members note the progress of the new AFA policy in improving the service's performance in respect of reducing unwanted fire signals, and the report will go into a little bit more detail to exemplify that. And we note the rationale and approve the risk of it assessments that underpin the protocols. We note the target of the approach to be adopted in relation to prolific offenders, which is envisaged will contribute to further improvements in performance. And I'll talk through the three-stage process we are proposing. And it was considered whether it would be appropriate to undertake a review and explore the experience of other fire rescue services who adopted a charging policy in respect of the potential to influence those prolific offenders and the financial impact on our authority. That was considered by Performance and Scrutiny. Performance and Scrutiny have asked members to consider us taking that particular aspect of it away and coming back to members with a little bit more detail on what the implications to the authority would be, what the success rates have been for other fire authorities who have undertaken that way, and whether that is something we would wish to explore in the future, notwithstanding the recommendations that are currently in this report. And finally, consider any additional recommendations arising from Performance and Scrutiny's considerations. That was broadly the only real key issue that they wanted members of this committee to kind of consider in those recommendations. Just as a little bit of background, and certainly for those members who are necessarily new to the authority, in November 2012 we sought to introduce a new policy, and that was on the basis of the previous 12 months us attending, or the authority attending, in a region of 5,394 unwanted fire signals. That is a significant, and clearly was a significant drain on our resources. You would also understand that the authority were predicting pretty significant reductions in those resources over that period, and the move from 42 appliances through to 32 to 28 and beyond. And it was clear that we needed to best and most effectively utilise those resources so they weren't spent protecting people and life risk rather than necessarily responding to unwanted fire signals, alarm actuations where there was no fire. As a result of that work, we commenced a period of consultation, and the consultation was comprehensive, and the comprehensive consultation allowed for stakeholder feedback, of which meant that we introduced our policy in two stages. introduced the first stage on November 2012, where appliances no longer attended non-domestic premises during the daytime. So we maintained our response to life risk incidents, and we have done throughout the kind of the introduction of the new policy. And then the second stage, which happened 12 months later, was to not attend those same non-domestic properties and premises during the night time. As a result of the implementation of that policy, and stage one, there was a 50% reduction in the number of calls, unnecessary calls to the service, of which 97.3% of those calls are, and always have been, unnecessary. And stage two, the second year, we've seen an additional 21.5% reduction to 2,111 incidents over that period. Now, even cumulative, and even with a recent increase in the number of calls, and I'll explain why there's been an increase more recently, that is a 60.1% reduction in the number of unnecessary calls attended by the fire service, which is particularly important given our reducing resources. There has been a slight increase over the past number of months, and that is, we perceive to be predicated on changes to things like the Care Act, which has meant individuals are living in their own home, they are focused around vulnerable people staying within their home environment, and the facilitation through that is through Care Act. So we would still respond to those properties because there is life risk. Also, just for some kind of absolute clarity, we also, when we've analysed those calls that we would still mobilise to, and be rest assured, we would continue to mobilise to any call where there's a backup call, confirming that there's a fire. Of those top 10 offenders, 6 were in sheltered accommodation residencies, and that accounts to 48% of those unwanted fire signals that we still attend. As a result of that, part of this proposal is that we would target those particular offenders in the first instance before considering alternative measures. And the approach would be a three-step phased approach. Firstly, we will write to them informally and suggest a meeting and ways to resolve those particular issues and make improvements. Secondly, we would order the premises under the fire safety order and, if applicable, issue an action plan to improve those particular arrangements. And thirdly, where appropriate, we would consider enforcement action against those premises for not making the necessary improvements. What was considered was the potential to extend our current policy to consider not attending life risk incidents during the daytime, because clearly people are more likely to be in bed during the evening. But funnily enough, some of the more vulnerable members of the community in nursing homes probably spend a fairly amount of time in bed during the daytime. That's something we have to be incredibly conscious of. We also, which is part of the discussions and deliberations that performed the scrutiny, have considered or could consider the potential to charge prolific offenders, and that is the basis of the recommendation that came back from performance scrutiny, that we should take that away and consider that and bring that back to members in the future. But notwithstanding the fact that we are introducing an additional three-phased approach to tackling those offenders who are still offending, given the fact that we are still attending those calls due to life issues that are associated with that. There are some legal implications, and certainly, I saw council's opinion, certainly finance chairs saw council's opinion around the AFA policy that we've introduced, and there's not likely or very little liabilities based on the authority on the basis of the policy that they've implemented, and clearly there are statutory responsibilities on the fire and rescue service to support and help and assist those premises that we are targeting. So we would always look to support their improvement rather than necessarily enforce against that in the first instance, and that is again work in progress undertaken by the protection teams. In appendices A, gives you kind of a simple line graph which demonstrates the reductions in the number of calls. Appendices B provides an impact assessment against our policy, against the Chief Fire Officer Association's guidance. It is only guidance, and we broadly follow that guidance with the exception of a couple of areas which we believe would impact on our performance if we were to adopt that. And then the final elements of the appendices is an equality impact assessment, which looks at the kind of issues related to equality and any to you about that. So I'll place off there, Chair, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Any comments or questions from members?
Thanks, Chair. Page 11, 21. The question is this, is that in these premises, are the fire marshals given adequate and proper training?
That depends, okay, and what I mean by that, our experience is we visit nursing home sheltered accommodation blocks because we perceive it to be additional risk there. We've got examples in Strathclyde where we had a nursing home where fortunately 14 people perished as a result of a fire in that particular area. So we went out and conducted audits of all of those nursing homes in the Merseyside area to reassure ourselves that effective measures were in place. And sometimes, certainly in sheltered accommodation blocks now, they're not warden led. Okay, so the warden, you know, is not living in the premises. That presents us with problems, not necessarily in managing a fire situation, but extends to managing the automatic fire alarm actuations. And we work with those particular nursing homes, sheltered accommodation blocks to ensure that the safeguards are in place. And that information is where we have any concerns is related to the Quality Care Commission. So they would again go and revisit that premise if there were some issues around safeguarding of vulnerable people in any particular locality that we come across. So we've made really overt, direct response to the issues that we're experiencing in Strathclyde. And we've got measures in place to visit those premises on a regular basis to assure ourselves that training is in place, fire risk management measures are in place, and we are familiar with the building, the layout, and the circumstances and the occupancy. But on occasion, we will come across premises where the individuals are new, haven't had the requisite amount of training. And as I say, we will refer those premises into the local authority to look at some remedial action if that be appropriate.
If you wish to speak, because I just put my hand up. Just
I'll show you.
If it's related to the same one, I'm absolutely
is
fine.
Okay?
Yes, fine.
And it's page 12, 26, or 25 and 26, but I tend to agree with 25. My problem arises in terms of 26 is that we would have to go anyway, wouldn't we? We'd have to make the response. Well, I'm talking in terms of the cost and the setting up the charges, irrespective of whether we could collect or not, we would still have to make the response to these premises, and I'm not quite sure how we head around that one. Other than the fact that most people who are put into these accommodations are put in by the local authority into private accommodations, but in essence, they're nominated and put into them from the local authorities. And I don't know whether there would be an avenue down there where we could be covered in some way costs from the local authorities rather than start setting up a thing which would be chasing down a financial scenario.
Absolutely, I agree on all points. We undertook some public consultation prior to the implementation of the new AFA policy. One of the things that came out from the public was the fact that the public didn't feel it was necessarily the best use of public money to move it around public services. So, an example being at the time one of our political offenders was the hospitals, and we would be taking, we would be charging hospitals for us attending and taking money that could be invested in providing care and putting it back into the fire authority. And the public was a little bit, concerned about that approach, and that extends to local authorities in the same guise. And that was one of the reasons why we didn't progress the cost recovery model that exists for fire and rescue services and the charging aspects of it. But equally, all of the issues that you've identified as well about the process that would be involved in doing that could actually outweigh the benefits. And also you spend an awesome amount of time chasing the money and not getting the desired effect because you are still having to respond to those incidents because there is still life risk there and we still want to do that as a fire and rescue party. So whilst it was considered at the time, it was thought to be a little bit too early to explore it any further. However, there are some firefighters, not a great deal, but there are some firefighters who have gone down the charging model, and the recommendation for performance and scrutiny would be that we would go to those firefighters, see how they applied that, and then come back away from that and see whether it was appropriate to consider it for the Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, but quite part of, as I say, the recommendation.
I just want to clarify from the Performance and Scrutiny Committee that what members of that committee wanted to do was undertake a review themselves with all the appropriate information that the Deputy Chief is referring to, because quite clearly, there is a lot more information now since this decision was originally made, and it's within that committee's terms of reference to undertake that kind of review, not to make any decisions, but then to make recommendations back to the full authority or to this committee for any further action that needs to take place.
Thank you, Chair. Page 11, number 20. My concerns are here in the paragraph about fire alarm systems, the cheaper fire alarm systems, and that the numbers of these calls for these systems will increase. What I wanted to know is that when our teams go in and have to tackle a situation such as this, where these cheaper alarm systems are going off, do they recommend to whoever's in charge of where they go, that there is actually a system which one would say is like a gold standard, a particular system that they would recommend? Or if they can't, I would think surely that would be something that we should look at as an authority.
We wouldn't recommend particular systems, just given the kind of the nature of the role that we fulfil. What we do describe, particularly where we have prolific offenders, is, go to the technical detail, is a double knock system.
Yes.
So not necessarily applicable in care line premises, because they are domestic property, but in a nursing home, what a double knock system is, if one alarm went off in this room, say, an additional alarm went off in close proximity, it is highly unlikely that that's due to a defective head, or indeed, sometimes you get flips, little insects which get into the alarm system and actuate them. So it's unlikely that you would get two actuated simultaneously. And if someone institutes and puts into the premises a double knock system, that provides that real, the gold standard really around assuring ourselves that we are responding to potentially a fire there. And our staff, firefighters and our protection teams would recommend that people introduce a double knock system, which gives the individual, responsible persons, the reassurances, but also gives us the reassurance, and we would respond to these premises every single time.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This is a development policy. It's a policy that we've developed, we're living with, we're watching it, monitoring it. As an authority, we've been against, in principle, the idea of charging. For the point of view that most of the ones that we were attending were commercial premises, automatic fire alarm activation, and that can be managed. Actually, in living, sleeping risk, life risk, it's probably better just to go and, would we want to charge? Actually, as we know, in the ambulance service for road vehicle crashes, they can charge, or they can make a charge against the insurance for the crashed vehicles without going into too much complication. We can't. And, there would be lobbying, there'd be better issues over that. But if this was just about the money, that would be a better way to go. It's not about the money. It's about actually asking the worst offenders or repeat offenders to manage their equipment better, and trying to encourage them to manage their equipment better, because these automatic fire alarms, the encouragement of having fire alarms has saved so many lives. It has been so good, really. The initiatives that we have had of putting these into properties have been so successful that we don't want to discourage that in any way. But I think having a scrutiny over the whole issue is a very good idea. As a managerial point of view, we've stood against charging, because it would be a very small amount of money and it would send the wrong messages. But anyway, let's pass that over to performance and let them look at it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. Just as regards the 10 shelter accommodation, what's the breakdown of them? Are they private ownership or social landlord? The other one for the Wood Street one, not a square one, what sort of premises is that?
Both those are privately owned. So the vast majority of the sheltered accommodation blocks will be privately owned. Nursing homes less so, and then Council of Cairns has identified, and Concert Square area is privately owned as well. So it's a conglomeration of premises, funny enough. That's why we're having difficulties in regard to the alarm system, because it's about six or seven different premises that are linked through alarm systems. So it goes off in one, it goes off in all, and so you go to one week, and you go to another premise the next week, it's all the same alarm system, but the offenders arguably are seven different kind of groups or organisations or premise owners, so that's why that's a little more complicated for us to kind of bring them all together to address those particular issues. But what is kind of clear is, rather than be passive, we are being really proactive in our approaches to them. And we will be utilising that three-step process in regard to those prolific offenders, with the ability for performance exclusion to take away the charging-esque model and see whether there's any value in implementing that and bringing recommendations back to this group.
I think it should be impressed upon them, though, even though it might be problematic and a long drawn out process to try and place a charge on them or to chase a particular charge. But I think they should understand the impact that the consistent or persistent use of automatic firewalls has on the service. So while the false alarm goes off, it's obviously a crew that's deployed or two crews that's deployed. And then what if an emergency comes in at that particular time, then what do you do? And then to go there, and obviously it's the disruption that it has to the service, but also to those individuals. So if somebody was living in a sheltered accommodation or somebody was in a particular part of a hospital and they have to evacuate that building, all for no reason, for them to quite simply just change the methods of their automatic firewall system. So it's down to the managers, the owners of the premises, but also for the companies who supply this equipment. We can't be always expected as a charitable organisation, in a sense, to run to these properties where these individuals are responsible for managing their own premises. And it's the pressure that it places on this authority as emergency services that they need to understand that and take away. So we need to make sure that we do all we can to impress upon them. Because if we do go down the route of charging, what would be the typical charge that we could sort of claim from them?
We are, as any public authority, only allowed to recover costs, full costs, but we are only allowed to cover costs and not to make any profit. So any service that we do charge for example, sometimes we charge lift operators for rescue from lifts, and those charges are all wholly calculated upon the cost to the authority of that turnout. So it could be the cost of the appliance, the personnel, and any equipment that's used. But legally, we can only make full cost recovery.
Because there's an issue there about if they consistently ignore their calls, advice, then I think that's a serious thing, isn't it, for them, especially if it's a nursing home or sheltered accommodation. That can't be allowed to continue. Now, if it's anything that we can do as councillors for a particular area, or our influence through our local councils to get the council officials to go out and make checks as well, to put some pressure on these companies, then I think we need to do all we can, because it can't continue like this.
Yeah.
And about 3 years, basically, this policy was implemented back in 2011, so it's 3 years ago. Well, it's gone up to 4 years, basically, isn't it?
Yeah.
And how long are we going to allow it to go on for?
Just make a couple of observations there. What I wouldn't underplay is the significance positive outcomes we've reached in regards to that bit of quick brave at the time decision that the authority made to implement a policy around automatic firearms. We have fire rescue services up and down the country who are coming to Merseyside to review our policy based on the 60% reduction in the number of unnecessary calls that we've responded to over that period of time. That doesn't withstand the kind of comments of Councillor Hanratty in regards to, yes, we can just continue to be allowed to kind of operate in the same way as it has been now. But the look at improving performance, that three-stage affair, looks at not only supportive, but funny enough, step three does consider enforcement action in relation to prolific offenders. Now, that does then extend into the potential to charge, and again, that will be part and parcel of the consideration of the Performance and Scrutiny Committee. But we are doing quite well in the nice proper way in managing our unwanted fire signals. We can make improvements, is my view, and that three-stage approach should facilitate some improvements in that area. But the unnecessary movements around our appliances have to be reduced even more given the dramatic cuts that we fire authority are facing.
That's right. Thanks, Jim. I agree with David on what's been said in that regard. And I'm conscious, remember, is that the first thing that I walked into is how many cuts and how much savings we've got to make. I'm not talking in terms of making savings and rationalising, but the word rationalising means that you're reducing the actual service. Now, we're having to run out to these places all the time. If not a sort of a cost implication in regard to what it costs us, but a punitive one, which means that they will take more care in the future. That's why I asked about the fire marshals. Each premise should have a fire marshal, which would indicate, was it a fault of mine? If not, a quick telephone call or a quick, what's the name, and you've stopped, so you haven't incurred a charge or cost. When we're running out to these premises and we're sending an engine, the first on-scene engine is then going to come back and say, we don't need a second one, you know what I mean? But the second one's always ready, isn't it?
That's on its way.
And so there is a sort of a backup system that's following the thing. So the incurred cost is not just for the first engine that goes. The incurred cost is one is manned and up and ready and running, waiting for the, shall we make it or not? And we're now reducing stations to 2 10-minute per station, miles apart, in a big circle, or 10-minute,
yeah.
What's your 10-minute column? System that we've introduced. The incurred cost to us means that we can't do the work elsewhere. We've been proactive in the sense of we've been reducing the risk to fire in homes, smoke alarms and all that, and we've reduced all that. We've been reduced the fires by advice given to factories and what have you, and we're proactive in being that. But we're still having to reduce. We're targeting all our things to reduction of fire, but we still got to pay for that advice to go out and speak to people. So there is that incurred costs all the time. And now we're saying, or what we look like we're saying, is that we don't want to be charging for false alarms where they could have been knocked on the head on the premises where it was originally. You know what I mean? We're going out, we're having to attend because there's someone will ring 999 or the automatic fire alarm system. Cheap and nasty will go off, and then we're all running around there trying to chase a non-existent fire. Well, I think we should look at it.
They will be looking at it. It's not got to an agenda stage yet. As soon as any information has come back, it will come back to this committee. I'd like to make a comment. Very pleased to see that we're leading the way again, and that Simon and Maria from West Midlands and the Isle of Man are coming down to see what we've done. The 60% is very, very good. But a question I've got is, we did give some of the schools on Merseyside, and I know my authority was one of them, an extended lead on the schools going on to the second phase because they weren't ready with their own security, being that it's all that sorted now.
Yeah, we have, like anything, we just currently put this policy in place and not allow people to kind of address their own particular responsibilities. And so there are some premises that we exempted from the protocol because of the put forward is sufficiently good business case subject to to our kind of, you know, deliberations and subsurface railways and so on and so forth, as it's probably an example of that. We also, you know, we're initially going to introduce the policy on block, so on the first phase was going to be non-attendance to non-domestic premises, both in the day and in the night time. And based on the consultation with stakeholders, we chose to do it over a two-year period to phase it in. And where we had, it could be in a multitude, it could be in school, it could be anyone who saw some kind of latitude around the implementation, we worked with them so they were fully prepared for the introduction of the policy at a point in time when they met their requirements, because clearly there was budgetary considerations in the month of that as well. Introducing it by putting in a new alarm system, you know, takes a little bit of time, but so long as the intent was there from them, business owners, responsible persons to address the issue, we would work with them, and we would continue to work with the institutions or the organisations if we are to introduce a change to the policy in any way, shape or form.
Thanks,
sir.
Any other comments, questions? Do we all agree the recommendations, and especially C, to consider the additional recommendations arising from the Performance Scrutiny Commission? Agreed?
Agreed.
We move on to item 4.
Thanks, Chair. Hello again. I'll talk to you support. This report is quite closely related, as you will understand, to Report 5, which is Report 5 is a 10-year review of our fatal fire incidents. Agenda item 4 is a 12-month review of those same accidental dwelling fires and those fatalities that have occurred with it. The purpose of the report is to request that members scrutinise the performance and detailed analysis relating to accidental dwelling fires that occurred in the year 2014-15, and recommendation that members note the performance in relation to this report in regards to those accidental dwelling fires, and the fact that that will inform our home safety strategy and functional plans moving forward. Fire fatalities are one of our key performance indicators, the key performance indicator 45. And you know, for your benefit, I will summarise the details of the fatalities that occurred. What I would point out is 10 fatalities is the first time we've been double figures for a number of years. But that's in context of us actually seeing a reduction in the number of accidental dwelling fires over the same period, but an increase in the number of fatalities. So it's with those caveats that I will introduce in the summary. Summary itself is during 14-15, there were 10 fatalities in accidental dwelling fires, two more than in 13-14, and five more than during 11-12. So, you know, quite a significant increase. Of the accidental dwelling fires that occurred, there were no incidents in Knowsley, there were four in Liverpool, two in Sefton, one in St Helens, and three on the Will over that 12-month period. Of the 10 fire deaths, seven of the victims were over 65 years of age. Okay, and when we talk about the 10-year review, there is clearly a theme there. Certainly, you know, members will be aware, but certainly our newer members may not necessarily be aware of the kind of the vulnerability profile for fire-related matters. The investigations into the causes of the fires identified that three were linked to smoke materials, two due to electrical faults, and two were related to careless use of heating appliances, and two related to cooking, and one related to the use of candles. There is six of the 10 fatalities occurred in 50% of the most deprived wards across Merseyside, or areas across Merseyside. This does suggest a possible link between deprivation and fire death, and again that is reinforced within the 10-year report. It's not massive, but there is a link to deprivation and causal factors. Of the 10 fatalities, 5 occurred on a Friday. Okay, this is a 12-month period. When you look at the 10-year review, then the most prolific days were a Monday and a Saturday. So again, it's just with that kind of reassurances or context in which this report is set, because it's only being over a 12-month period. Of the 10 fatalities, and this is really key for members to have a full understanding of, 9 victims lived alone or were alone at the time of the incident. So count some of the key causal factors: people over 65 years of age, people who live alone are more vulnerable, and certainly our home safety strategy, which it does, will target our resources to those particular vulnerable individuals. 8 of the properties have received a home fire safety check out of the 10. again, which should reassure members that we are working in the right places, even with diminishing resource. On 5 occasions, the smoke alarm actuated. On 1 occasion, the smoke alarm had been disabled. On a further occasion, it didn't operate because there wasn't sufficient smoke to get the alarm to actuate. And on a further occasion, albeit home fire safety check had been undertaken, the individual refused to have a smoke alarm fitted in their property. Fortunately, the old adage of an Englishman's castle is as well, is still stands true, and we have no requirements on them to comply with our suggestions. And you know, that this 12-month review, as I say, in conjunction with the 10-year review of fire fatalities, will inform our home safety strategy moving forward. That home safety strategy will come back to members for you to to note and approve. But you will understand it will reflect all of the matters that have been identified in the annual and the 10-year report. And I'm happy to take any questions about anything in this year.
Any questions or comments?
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to comment on one of the two fatalities, which was in Sefton. The gentleman that died actually lived in a house which backed onto my back garden. So I do know quite a bit about this, and I really want to thank those the crews that were involved in coming out and doing reassurance to our residents, because they visited almost 300 houses in the following 2 days, which was no mean feat for them to get round. And they actually fitted, I believe, 108 smoke alarms went up. They came to my property. The only thing was that they put a fire angel smoke alarm up upstairs, but we have had problems with that because it is a sealed unit. So that's something I'm a little bit concerned about, whether anybody else has had problems with this unit or whether it's just a one-off. And of course, you have to then go to get another one and put that in. So that did concern me a bit, whether some residents, if their alarm doesn't go off and it's meant to be a 10-year one, obviously. What they can do on that one.
Okay, thanks, Councillor. I suppose the first part that I am reassured, you're reassured. We have fire fatalities across Merseyside, and then we do a community reassurance campaign, which means we go out and spend a couple of days at least, extends into weeks sometimes, working with the communities to reassure them about our fire risk, but also install smoke alarms where that be appropriate. We moved to a sealed unit some years ago, and clearly when we first started this process, we were installing 1-year units which you could take the battery out of, and that presented us with problems because A, we had to replace them every year, or the occupier did, and 2, individuals were taking the batteries out and utilising them elsewhere. Mm-hmm. So we moved to a sealed unit, and now and again, and it is only now and again we have issues with some of those sealed units in the same way as you would have with any electrical device. Now, what I would say is, and would be left with every resident in Merseyside that would have visited, if there's ever any problems with those alarms and they've been installed by the fire and rescue authority, then it's just that we contacted the fire and rescue authority and we would come back and take
Well, I did ring and they did say there would be a charge for that, which I would accept because I did know from when we went to speak with fire crews that the fire station visits, the cost of them is nearly £28, So I said no, because we've sorted that out ourselves. So hopefully it is just this blip.
Yeah, and then I hope you look along the charging aspect of the interpretation. But the fact of the matter is, we would come back out and install a fresh alarm for you under those circumstances, given it was a hotspot campaign and given it was probably the first time you've had an alarm fitted by the authority. Mm. The fact that it became faulty, we would have replaced that.
Okay.
So apologies for that, but we would address that under normal circumstances.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other comments or questions on the items on the agenda?
Thanks, Chair. Obviously, we welcome the report, obviously looking at the last 12 months, but also the last 10 years. And it's sad to say that obviously we've seen an increase in fire deaths on the back of all the community fire prevention work that we've done over the last 10 years. And you have to look at the details behind those fire deaths, and when you think about 75% of them were over the age of 65, and as the deaths quite rightly said, they all probably lived alone. And I think it's more important now when you look at the demographics of the county and working with local authorities and all the other agencies, where we highlight and identify these vulnerable people. Because we get told that obviously people are living long there's an increase in mental health, there's an increase in dementia, and Alzheimer's and that. So our risk is actually getting higher. And these are all unknowns to us. These are people who probably we're not aware of, we don't see. But it's only because the fire service was brand that we're able to get through those people's, overdose people's front doors to go and do an assessment. And I think it's important that we, you know, this report, I think, should be shared with the health and wellbeing boards and also with the local authorities, with their sort of select committees, for them to have a look at the detail of this, because it's working clever, closer together with the health and wellbeing boards, with the local authorities, to make sure we get the appropriate data to identify these individuals, to make sure that we go in and do a home fire safety check, but also doing a health and wellbeing check as well, which we need to examine more and explore more with the health service, because we can do this. You know, we can do a lot more of the prevention where that would be added value and reduce the impact of, obviously, the if there's a coroner's inquest and the report, then the cost of that on the public payers is, I understand, it's £1 million. So if we were there to look at the individual's sort of living habits and sort of mobility and medical issues, and maybe signpost them to other organisations and services, you know, we might help prevent somebody losing their life through fire. And I think as the demographics change and the risk change, I think it's more important for us to be part of that data and part of that visit to make sure that we go to these most vulnerable people to make sure that we do all we can to protect them. And that's the change, I think, what we're going through within the fire service. But, you know, I think for me, there's a bit of an agency to it. You need to do it now rather than wait another 12 months or so, where you can see the impact of the austerity measures and whether this is an impact or some of these deaths are an impact, a direct impact, because of cuts. Because you look at some of them, there's somebody using candles. Were they using candles because, electricity? Two of them were electrical suppliers. Did they buy those goods through car boot sale? Did they buy them off eBay? Did they buy them somewhere else that hadn't had the proper check on them? And if it's the likes of that people will turn to in order to save money and whatever, that we need to ensure that we can give appropriate support, guidance and advice. And I hope that along, but you know, we see the implement the cuts, affected the cuts, now starting to take impact into the local community. And I hope that this isn't a sign that fire deaths are on the increase, because if it is, then I think we need to ensure that we do what we can to highlight this through our partners, but also through to the government as well, because I think it's a very important issue.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Sorry,
David.
Thanks for that, because I was really concerned about the fuel poverty aspect of this. When I read through a little bit of the panel, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, it couldn't have really been as an aid to see in the dark at 2 o'clock in the afternoon when the fire was called. But I am really concerned, and I do agree that it should be going on health and wellbeing agendas, because open flame fires now should not be allowed. Any person living on the road. Central heating should be in all our buildings, or if not that, then them oil radiators that I know that the authority do give out in certain cases. But I do agree it should be on the health and wellbeing board. I'd just like to see what's going on in Merseyside. Do you want to come back?
Yeah, only just to cut the provide some reassurance to members.